Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
At this time, I'll call our meeting to order, and I'm going to call on Ms. Vaughn for our invocation, please.
Let's pray. Oh, God of all time and people, we thank you for health sufficient to be here and for your unconditional love. At this time, we ask for wisdom sufficient to discern truth from hollow promises and convenient rhetoric. Forgive us for insisting on simple solutions when the issues confronting our world are complex and daunting. May we have the courage and stamina to insist on platforms that serve the general welfare rather than the special interests. At all times, keep us mindful that there can be no peace without justice for all your children. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, we don't have any public comments, I understand. So we will move on to Ms. Sherry Hook with the introduction of interns.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. I'm here tonight to talk to you about our internship program. Internships allow the county to take advantage of the opportunity to expose students to the workforce while having them work on projects or have them conduct routine tasks that allow our regular staff to concentrate on projects that they can't normally get around to. For several years, we've utilized interns from UNCG, UNC Chapel Hill, Appalachian, and Elon. And mainly those have been in the health department and in DSS, but this year we broadened the program and encompassed other departments as well. What I was hoping to do was be able to introduce you to the interns tonight, but with it being 7 o'clock on a school night, I couldn't get any to come. So I'm just going to go down the list and tell you who we've got and where they're, what departments they're in. Elon University, we have Amelie Bush. She's going to be working in the finance department. Lindsay Gretsch will be working with me in human resources. Matthew Sullivan and Martin Burke are going to be working with the sheriff's office. Kristen Delforge is going to be working with the legal department. And then from UNCG, Ashawn Parker is going to work with the health department. And then Brittany Markle will work with social services. We are still working with our internship program, and so we're still looking to fill positions in fire marshal, GIS, and also recreation and parks. Our hope is through the internship that these students get an overview of the departments that they're going to be working in, and they get some good hands-on practical experience in their field of study, and the county gets to benefit from their work as well. Each of these internships is unpaid. So I hope that you'll join me as you see these folks walking around welcoming them to Alamance County and especially thanking them for volunteering their time to work with us.
Okay.
Any questions?
Yeah, Sherry, I think it's a great experience. How long will they be with us?
Most of them are going to be with us through this spring semester, so they'll be with us through the end of April or early May.
And are they graded?
Some of them are taking the internships for class credits. Some of them are just doing the internship so that they will have something to put on their resumes.
Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and now I want to call on Mr. Gary Cole from the Judicial Service Coordination. He's going to do an announcement of Criminal Justice Partnership Program Award.
Good evening.
Hey, Gary.
Appreciate you giving me a moment here. The State Criminal Justice Partnership Program was created in 1993, and it's administered through the Department of Correction. What this program does is provides funding to counties to help offset costs of intervention services for high-risk offenders who are on community supervision. Alamance County established a CJP program here in 1994, and Judicial Services has provided fiscal and administrative oversight of these funds since then, and reports directly to our local advisory board consisting of members of the judiciary, law enforcement, Commissioner Vaughn, and several at-large members of our community. Services covered by these funds include outpatient substance abuse treatment, sex offender assessment and treatment, halfway house services, and non-medical detox. During fiscal year 08-09, we served 98 offenders with these funds, and a recidivism study conducted in 2008 by Elon University showed that this program produced a lower recidivism rate than the state and national average for offenders that did not participate in such a program. Each year, the state CJP board recognizes four programs from across the state with a Program of Excellence Award, and I'm pleased to announce that Alamance County was named as one of those recipients for fiscal year 08-09 during a state CJP board meeting in Wilson. We couldn't do this without the support of the commissioners and the county administration in general, and of course, community corrections and my staff. And I just wanted to share a little bit of good news
with you. Thank you so much.
That is good news.
Congratulations.
Thanks for your hard work.
If there'd been a fat check attached to that,
that would have helped, wouldn't it?
That would have helped.
We appreciate it so much, the work that you do with this.
Okay, the next, I think you all have this letter in your packet from Barbara Garrison, and she is here. If you have any questions of her, if you'd like to come up, Ms. Garrison, at this time. Okay, that'd be fine. And I do support this, by the way. I'm going to put my name on.
Madam Chairman, Chairwoman.
That's okay.
Commissioners, ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate your letting us come before you tonight, and we appreciate the support of your appointee to our committee, the Honorable Ann Vaughn. We are here before you because we have an issue that we need your support for with the legislature. Many elderly whom we represent are living below the poverty line in Alamance County. The economy is bad, but they are impacted by property taxes, which may prevent them from remaining independent in their own homes. Willie Mae Curran has calls all the time about problems such as this. She and George Adams, who is with us tonight, he was instrumental in forming the letter you see before you, and they are members of the Tar Heel legislature. I would ask that they might just speak a word or two after I read the letter, which will carry my signature. This is going to our representatives and Senate in the legislature. The Alamance County Planning Committee for Services to the Elderly is requesting your support for North Carolina House Bill 423, which was introduced in March 2009. The Alamance County Planning Committee is charged to identify the needs of the adults 60 and better, their caregivers, and individuals with disabilities in Alamance County, and make recommendations for funding through the Home and Community Care Block Grant. Older adults, professionals, senior Tar Heel legislators, and volunteers are the membership of this committee with appointment by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. The current income eligibility limit for this Homestead Exemption Act is $25,000 per taxable year. The exemption level for income has to increase from $30,000 to $35,000 annually to follow the current recommendation of the North Carolina Senior Tar Heel Legislature. The Alamance County Planning Committee for Services to the Elderly would like to see this bill passed into law in the approaching short session. With the cost of living increasing and incomes decreasing or remaining unchanged, the current legislation is counterproductive to seniors whose primary goal is to remain independent. The 2000 census estimates that 12 7/10% of North Carolina's adults over 65 have a fixed income below the poverty level. Frequent assessments of property value have resulted in much greater tax burdens within this population, adding to the worry of remaining independent. The Alamance County Planning Committee for Services to the Elderly would like you to join us in supporting a positive change for all of North Carolina's senior citizens and support North Carolina House Bill 423, increasing the income eligibility from $25,000 to $35,000. Thank you. Now, I'd like George to come up and just say a word or two.
The main purpose of this letter is to hopefully get House Bill 423 out of committee where it's stuck. That's what it's all about.
Okay. Thank you.
Willie Mae, would you like?
It's my joy to have worked with you for 16 years now, and I'll be starting the 17th in July. It's been a great opportunity to work with you. And in the senior legislature, we submit five priorities to the General Assembly every year. And for about 5 years now, we have submitted the homestead exemption problem to you. Part of it that was brought up last time in 2009 and is going to be carried to 2010 would be to establish a cap on the increase in the assessed value of property. And thank goodness you did something about that in Alamance County. We know about that. Thank you very much, because when the property tax go way up and we have 12 7/10% of North Carolina's elderly over 65 who are below the poverty line, there was no way they could pay additional tax. So we were pleased with that. And then another part of it was that we should revise the limits of the Homestead Income Tax Act to income of $35,000. So we are supporting that in the counties and also throughout the senior legislature. And we worked very hard to do quite a few things there, and it's been my pleasure to have worked there. And I constantly say that Alamance County is number one of the 100 counties in North Carolina. And if you don't believe that we're first in a lot of other things, you just come down and see, because we are. We work with wonderful people, and you have been such great supporters of the Planning Committee, and I've been on that since 1990, and I'm a charter member of the senior legislature, and they've been two of the greatest things that have happened in my life, other than teaching all of these Alamance County students that I've had an opportunity to teach. And I also told you that we were working with this relay for extra help, and I gave you copies of that. I just want you to be informed that we have already reached in this region the number of people that we believe have needed this extra help. There were 88,000 people in North Carolina who did not have money to pay for their prescriptions. And with the Department of Insurance in Raleigh, and also with the SHIP organization in the state, we've already reached 4,900. So that's our quota in region. Thank you for what you do. Thank you for supporting us. And you do a marvelous job supporting us, and thank you. We appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
You want your... Ms. Garrison, you want your letter? That's the one you want to send in.
All right. Well, that one was for you.
Oh, okay. Okay. Oh, thank you. Okay, the next thing on our agenda.
Would you like for a corresponding letter to be sent on behalf of the board? Is that the wish?
Yeah, that would be fine.
Like a resolution. Yeah. I mean, we want a resolution.
As a resolution.
I would say, as a board, if we did a resolution, that would maybe carry a little bit more.
That would be fine with me.
We can do something for our next meeting.
Do we have a consensus on that tonight?
Yes.
Yeah.
We have a consensus tonight.
We'll bring it back and put it under consent agenda for our next meeting.
Okay.
Can I add something?
Sure.
Willie Mae, the retired school personnel will be meeting Thursday at noon. I think you've been a guest there before. But our guest speaker this Thursday will be a lady, I believe, from SHIP. If you want to attend that, you're certainly welcome to. I extend you that invitation.
Thank you. That's wonderful. But we've spoken all over the county to individuals and to groups about this, and we've carried this material about the relay for extra help to pharmacists, to druggists, to churches, to doctors, to the clinics, and we've tried to make everybody aware of it so that we could reach the largest number of people.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you for letting me come.
The next thing on our agenda is Jason Martin. If you will, Jason, if you'll go ahead and explain
Madam Chair, Commissioners, good evening. I originally had intended to come before you tonight to set a public hearing on the Jordan Lake Rules buffer ordinance. You should have in a packet a memo that kind of explained everything there. With the Jordan Lake Rules, there is a requirement to extend our buffer protection to from perennial streams to perennial and intermittent streams. And the county has to submit a model ordinance within 6 months of the effective date of the rules, which would be March 10th. The state actually submitted a model ordinance towards sometime in December for us to consider around the same time we were doing the adaptive management plan. And we were able to get this in front of the planning board, and I gave them a few options with these rules last Thursday night. And the planning board at that time voted, made a motion to direct me to make additional amendments to the watershed ordinance as opposed to the model ordinance. And since then as well, the chairman has instructed me to call a special meeting of the planning board for this coming Monday night, which we will get notice out for that as well. So at this time, let me explain that the buffer ordinance and the requirements, we do not have to adopt something by March 10th. We have to submit something to the state. My goal in mind was to set a public hearing so that we could take public input by March 10th, but we do not have to do that. We have to have a public hearing before we can adopt an ordinance. If we submit something before March 10th, the state will send us back comments within 6 months, and then we will have 2 months to hold a public hearing and adopt it. So we do not have to do that tonight, but if it is the board's wish to set a public hearing for March 1st, then by all means, I'll be glad to advertise that. And I did bring copies of the draft model ordinance I'm going to distribute to you all tonight, just for your information. As I'm not requesting any action or anything, but I just felt like it would be important for you to have that so you can see what the state has passed down to us.
Okay. What's your pleasure? You want to have set a public hearing or wait till they
talk
about
it? Planning ought to do what they're going to do. Let the planning go with it.
Yeah, let y'all have a meeting Monday and then bring it back to us and let us see what you came up with.
Just to kind of help Jason out here a little bit from the meeting, the basic consensus of the planning board was to take and just modify our watershed ordinance instead of what the state's trying to cram down our throat, to send them something and let them, if they don't like it, then they can do what they want with it. But
well, that's fine with me.
Sure.
And that's what, if you'll do that for us.
Is that workable?
Yeah, absolutely. And if you all wish to for me to come back for an informational meeting to go over with what with you what the planning board has decided before I submit it to the state, I'll be glad to do that as well.
Or maybe you can just come back out on the next meeting.
Okay.
Jason, can I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
I have a feeling, or maybe it's misinformation, that the state is changing it as it moves along.
I don't know that I would say that it's changing as it's moving along, but the getting a definition is, in a lot of times, has been like nailing Jell-O to the wall, for the lack of better words. But I don't know that it necessarily has changed as we're moving along. The basic consensus of Jordan Lake Rules is still there. But there's a lot of questions. There was a good question brought up by one of our planning board members at the planning board meeting of what do you do if you have to cross a stream to put in a septic system? You know, and you have to disturb that. And in those cases, you know, are you subject to criminal penalties and civil
penalties?
And yeah, there's some very good questions that still need to be answered, and I've been trading emails back and forth and phone calls back and forth with the state, and I just got a handful of our questions answered today, but still kind of working through that and try to find a way to take 35 pages worth of model ordinance and condense it down to something that's a little bit more digestible, I guess, to where people can read it and really understand what's being said. So,
well, what you have in here, I really do appreciate, and appreciate your hard work, yours and the board's.
Yeah, thank you. Want to give that, I'll pass it in. The sad part about this is the state of North Carolina owns Jordan Lake.
All of it.
and they're the ones that send it out, and I found that on the internet. They bought it several years ago. That's what I found on the internet. But we won't get any of that. We won't get any of that water if we need it, I promise you. Okay. Thank you, Jason.
Is all of Jordan watershed in our county in our watershed?
The bulk of Alamance County will be covered by the Jordan watershed, with the exception of a very small portion in the northeastern corner.
Up near Pleasant Grove areas.
And the bottom corner, but in the bottom southwest, but that's also covered by existing watershed. And yeah, there were a lot of concerns that came out of the planning board meeting, particularly with enforcement and things like that. Right now, we are charged with the enforcement for our existing watershed areas, but nothing that's added by the Jordan rules. The state would assume that based on what they've told me. But there's still some concerns, too, that have been expressed in the state in enforcing anything. So.
Well, in the best case scenario, my understanding is it's not going to cost the county that much, but the municipalities will be paying dearly. Is that true?
Well, the municipalities, my understanding, it will impact them a great deal because they have wastewater treatment facilities, and that is the bulk of their retrofitting and upgrading. That would be very expensive. And I think I saw something in the paper that kind of reflected with the water and sewer rates and a few of the municipalities what, you know, basically what this is going to impact. So. The county, from our end, is going to be more of an issue of manpower and versus trying to do the enforcement of the ordinance rules. And, of course, as I've said, my goal is to make it to where we don't have to add anything more than what we currently have, especially in this in the times we're in right now. So.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay, next we have Dave Leonard, our fire marshal, with an update on the 800 megahertz system. Are you?
Madam Chair and Commissioners, we are pleased to submit this report tonight on the status of the Viper communication system for Alamance County Emergency Services. Currently, we are awaiting approval from the state Viper administrator on the templates that were submitted on 1/26 of 2010. The templates will provide us with the channels that we will be programming into our radios. Once this approval has been received, the templates are forwarded then to the Motorola vendor to be computerized. This usually takes about 3 to 4 weeks for this process. The templates will then be downloaded into all the radios, the mobiles, and the portables and the base stations. The next step is to install the mobile radios into the emergency service equipment. Law enforcement, fire, rescue, and EMS. Mobile radio installation is currently ongoing. As we receive new vehicles in, especially in the law enforcement EMS, we've been trying to outfit them with their 800 radios right now, so we'll be a little ahead of the game when it comes time to installing all the 800 radios into the current equipment that we have out there. 6 additional communication channels have been purchased to enhance our interoperability. 3 each will be installed on the Cane Creek and the Altima Hall towers by Viper maintenance personnel, and this is at no cost to Alamance County. This project was funded by the COPS grant that we received last summer. A communications tower and all of its components will be installed at the new Fire Marshal's office on Martin Street, the Family Justice Center, to be utilized by CECOM and Burlington's Communications as an emergency backup dispatch to our current and their communication system as well. And again, portions of this was also funded by that grant that we received last summer. A mobile communication center has been purchased with grant funds and will serve the emergency services organizations in Alamance County. This unit will have mobile radios, a command center, and all the necessary equipment that we need to utilize in any type of incident. This is currently being outfitted to the specifications which we wrote in the grant, and we expect a delivery possibly by April 15th. Our go-live date for Motorola, once the templates are in hand, is looking at approximately May 15th. If there are no glitches from the Viper administrator, we hope to have this in place by May 15th, and that's what we're shooting for. Also, the renovations to the 911 center is well over 95% complete downstairs. The last remaining things they're having to do is some offices off of the existing 911 center. At this time, I'll entertain any questions you may have regarding our update on the Viper system.
Well, I've been downstairs, and it looks great down there.
It's impressive.
It really is.
We're looking forward to the center over at the Family Justice to be just as nice as that, too. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Good. No questions.
Thank you,
Dave. Thank you, Dave. Okay, Mr. Burgess, if you will come and talk about the Facilities Improvement Plan Roofing Bundle Part B1 bids.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. As a follow-up to your February 1st meeting, I'm asking this evening that you approve the Part B1 roofing bundle contract with Allied Roofing Company. As you recall, at the last meeting, we had to rebid that project because we did not have a sufficient number of bids originally. It was rebid. The low bid with Allied Roofing Company is in the amount of $566,500. So we would ask tonight that the board approve that contract and also approve the amended project cost summary that is included in your agenda package.
Any questions, Mr. Burns?
Did they sign the new addendum going with the E-Verify?
The contract, that process is still, as far as your executing contract, that's still in the process of getting that done. So they're still working on that. So those haven't been executed yet that I'm aware of.
Once they are executed and signed off, it will include that statement. There was one contract that we had this week on some timber cutting.
The timber deed that's put out to bid has that language there. That will have that language.
Right.
And the architects have been made aware of that provision. So.
Mr. Burgess, I had a call from a roofer in Alamance County and said he was turned down the first time, but he had his certificate, whatever he needed, and I don't see his name on here, so I don't know.
There were two roofing projects. There was a smaller roofing project, and this is the larger one. This is the HNC building. There was another project that included several other locations, but was a smaller one, and it could have been in that project itself.
Okay.
So that may have been.
And
that was.
I just wanted to make sure because he did tell me he was certified to do whatever.
That may have been in
routing. They told him he couldn't even put a bid in the first time.
I had a question on similar.
So that kind of bothered me.
What they did on this larger, because this is a very large project, and not everybody can do this. This amount of work on a project. What they did on these is they pre-qualified and went through a process of pre-qualifying the bidders to make sure that they met certain requirements before they were actually allowed to bid on the project. The pre-bidding process was advertised, and so they were given an opportunity to pre-qualify, and that's might be what they were talking about.
Well, this, it may be, and that was for the first bidding, and then we didn't have enough, and he called me, and I told him that it was open again.
Okay. So I thank everybody that what happened is three bid on the original bids on this project here. Mm-hmm. Three bid, however, one of the three was 20 minutes late, and by statute, you can't accept it. So we only had two bids. You have to have about three by statute. So we had to re-advertise, went through the process again.
Okay.
Not sure how we advertised, but went back through the process again. And then we received, and I assume they were the same three bidders that bid the second time as they did the first time. What his issue may have been is it could have been that he did not pre-qualify in order to submit a bid.
Okay.
I'll check. I had a question on some roofing there. And we had actually awarded that contract last month, and one of the guys that had bid on that was actually withdrawn from it. And in talking with him, when we set our specifications for product, who is actually doing the specification?
There is there's an engineer that works with the architectural firm that's an expert in the roofing materials and whatever area of engineering that would be. He would be the one that works with the architect to set the specifications for the
Because product. In talking to this guy today, I called him up and talked to him a little bit, and was just curious why he had withdrawn his bid, and he was telling me his product carries a warranty with it that actually covers contents should something happen. Mm-hmm. And I'm just a little concerned that maybe we are not really looking to all depths of saving the county some money and still have maybe even a better product.
that would be a question for the engineers and the architects, really, as far as how they determine how to spec these projects out. I know that the engineer that they use is very experienced in
Sometimes that's costly when you got a very experienced person in some of those positions. They're not looking for new products or good products that are maybe available at a less cost. I was concerning to me that we possibly could have spent $40,000 extra last month that we might could have saved in this process.
Yeah, and if I tried to answer that, I'd be speaking out.
I understand. So, I just wanted to make a point of that maybe you and Sammy Upps, whoever's looking over this stuff too, do a little investigation and see if there are available products that we can be using, especially on these roofing packages, that provide better warranties and give you,
And if you want me to, I'll be glad to talk with you and get some more information from you so that we can find out more about that.
That's okay. Well, I think we do because, I mean, if you have I know in the building industry, you go to an international builder show in Las Vegas and there's 30 different products, same, roofing. But you've got various degrees of stuff. And some carry better warranties than the high price stuff,
Yeah. And your architects aren't always. Sometimes architects set up things to award. It's as bad as it sounds. To award their buddies on different things. So that is a problem. Yeah. It definitely is something to look at.
I just wanted to bring that up because it was concerning last month when we did that, and I'd seen that one of them had withdrawn his bid, and I was curious, and I called him and just talked to him about it. He said, well, I offered a product, but it wasn't on your spec sheet. But he said, my product carries 25 years. The one there did carries 15 years. My product also carries warranty if you have water damage that it covers content where theirs didn't.
If you want me to, I'll be glad to have the architect give you a call that's been kind of overseeing these projects, and because he can probably maybe be able to shed some light on it, or you may be able to shed some light on it.
I mean, I think if we can save money on looking at those specs, I think that'd be a good thing to do.
Yeah, 25 years certainly beat 15.
I'll be glad to have him give you a call if that's okay.
Any other questions, Mr. Burgess? So do we need to approve this? Is that what you're saying?
Yes, ma'am. Approve both the contract and the amended project cost summary there.
Do I hear a motion that we approve this contract and the amended budget?
So moved.
Motion. Second.
I'll favor. Second.
Aye. Opposed. All right. Next. We approve.
Thank you, Carter.
We approve.
Yeah, I have the next item.
Oh, you got another.
Yes, next item for you.
I thought I was through with you.
You want to go ahead and start on that one?
Oh, the courthouse annex name, yes.
Yes, ma'am. You have before you in your agenda packets a letter from Judges Jim Robertson and J.B. Allen, Jr. requesting to change the name of the court annex building that's attached to the county office building from court annex to the Alamance County Civil Courts building. As you know, the building down the street is known as a criminal courts building. They would like for this one to be known as a civil courts building, since what they primarily have in this courtroom is civil cases. It'll be a little less confusing to the public, because with this being named as the court annex, the question is, what is it the annex to? Well, it's the annex to the criminal courts building, but it doesn't typically handle criminal cases in here. We're getting ready as part of the remodeling project to do some signage for the building, and that's kind of how the discussion came up as to whether there was a better name than court annex, and that's what kind of got the discussion started. So before you tonight, you do have a request from those two judges to rename the court annex building beside us.
Okay.
I'll move.
Second.
At least there wasn't a name attached to it.
Yeah.
That saved a lot of controversy, right?
Thank you, Mr. Burton.
Thank you.
I didn't say that.
Next is budget amendments 87 and 88 from the Health Department. Mr. Bass.
Thank you, Madam Chairman, Commissioners. We have received some additional funding. First of all, the through the Division of Public Health for some child-related programs that we were actually the fiduciary agents, and that the money's going to come to the health department, but we're going to be able to work with our partners in system of care. That grant, as you can see, is in the sum of $50,000 for strengthening families. And we're going to be dividing it up into two different components. One is the Incredible Years program with our partner at the Alamance Partnership for Children in the sum of $34,107.50. And the second one is the Strengthening Families with the Dispute Services and Dispute Settlement Youth Services partner, and that's at $15,892.50. And we'll look at this as a real opportunity to expand these two particular programs. For the Incredible Years is dealing with child behavior kind of programs, and then the Strengthening Families is trying to help families to make sure that they're going to be having good outcomes and reducing opportunities for juvenile recidivism and such, and working with this dispute settlement. So that's the grant for our Strengthening Families. Again, we will be the managing the grant and the fiduciary agent with these other two agencies, and we'll be following up with them with the accountabilities and such. And these are best practice programs.
Any questions of Mr. Bass on that? I hear a motion we accept this budget amendment.
So moved.
I have a motion.
And
second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Okay.
And the second one is kind of a mini grant that we've just gotten from the North Carolina WIC Program Division of Public Health in the sum of $4,066.34. And our intention here is to $466.34. And these funds will be used to enhancements in our own site breastfeeding program. We have a room back in our WIC department where we do some teaching and education with the ladies who are learning about breastfeeding, and we're going to be buying some furniture and some lighting, as well as buying some educational materials that we'll be taking out to physician practices to encourage their patients to use breastfeeding. So that's what this enhancement is for.
I hear a motion. We accept this budget amendment.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Bass. Okay, the next is County Manager's Report.
Excuse me. Thank you, Madam Chairman. It gives me great pleasure this evening to introduce our new librarian, Ms. MJ Goodrum. And MJ, if you would stand up, please. We have met with her today with the library staff, so we've already had those pre-introductions. But Ms. Goodrum will begin her new job as of March 8th. MJ has spent her last, is it 14 years with Chapel Hill? 16 years with the Chapel Hill Library System, and we're excited about her willingness to come and help us. One of the reasons why she was hired, she is a Burlington resident, so we don't have to worry about moving expenses. So, so she is already a county resident, and but we're excited. We had a very good process that we went through to hire her and fill the position. We had a very good committee, and I would like to thank the committee members who helped during this process. Carlene Morton and Carrie Thompson from the Library Committee, Assistant County Manager Tim Burgess, and HR Director Sherry Hook and myself. But while MJ's here and we're excited about her starting, I do want to publicly thank Martha Sink. Martha, if you will please stand as well. Martha has done an extremely wonderful, I could not be more proud of the work that Martha has done the last couple of months. She took this role on reluctantly, has done an admirable, outstanding job in her role. We probably have more issues in the library in the last couple of months dealing with things than Judy had in 20 years, but Martha really has handled it extremely well, and I'm very proud of the work that she's done, and we're very lucky to have both of them. And we just want to introduce MJ. MJ, would you like to say anything?
My family has a long history of public service, and I'm very honored and very excited about being able to continue that by serving Alamance County. I'm looking forward to working here and working with the library and working with you all.
We're glad you're here.
Yeah.
We are happy you're here.
Thank you.
And thank you, Martha.
And I do want to give you one quick update on our employee health clinic. We're in week three that started today. The first week we had 26 appointments.
Wow.
Last week we had 52.
Good.
So have heard nothing but very positive feedback from all our employees from all across the organization. It has been very well received and very well used. We will keep you updated on those numbers. And again, thank you to the commissioners for your willingness to let us try this program. And that's all I have at this moment.
Brad, it sounds like it's going good, too.
It's going very well.
Yeah. Okay. We will go ahead and do the consent agenda at this time. Does anybody have any questions or want to leave anything on that? Any questions on the consent agenda? If not, do I hear a motion to accept the consent agenda?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, at this time, we are going to go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143.318.11A4 to discuss matters relating to the location or expansion of industries or other businesses in Alamance County, including agreement on a tentative list of economic development incentives that may be offered in negotiations. And we will return. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
I'll second that.
Second. Okay. Thank you.